can you combine request-driven and event-driven architecture together? The answer is yes, you can combine the two. Hi, I'm Daniel Tamage, a senior solution architect who has been designing and architecting distributed event-driven systems for over a decade and a half. In this video, we will look at two possible solutions. FYI, I'm basing this solution on a question I received on one of my videos. The question was, can you combine request-driven and event-driven architecture together? Say you have a device that makes a post request every 10 minutes with a timestamp data to a REST API. How would you integrate this into an event-driven architecture, store the data into a database, and also display the data on a front-end app? Before we go through the two approaches, let me share my architectural design decisions. First, I will base my solution as if it was hosted in AWS. Second, I will use serverless services for the ease of delivery and scalability serverless provides. Thirdly, DynamoDB will be the choice of database because of its change data capture, CDC, stream functionality in the form of DynamoDB streams or DynamoDB Kinesis data streams. Fourthly, I will use AWS API Gateway to deploy, secure, monitor, and proxy operations to the backend. Fifth, Kinesis data streams is my choice of middleware because it's an event stream. I'm not going to use a message queue or a broker because I want long-term data retention and ability to have multiple consumers independently consuming the stream. And I want the ability to reprocess if I need to. Now remember, two fundamental principles. One, do not lose events. And second, don't do distributed transactions. Now, onto the patterns. The first approach is what I call database first, which is when the API stores the request straight to a database table. In this approach, I will use API Gateway as a proxy for DynamoDB by storing the data straight to DynamoDB without requiring a function to process the request and insert a record. However, if required, you can have a service or a function to serve the API endpoint and perform the insert based on your requirements. Now, after successfully adding the record, the operation will notify that the operation was successful in the response back to the device. Once the device data gets stored in DynamoDB, the change gets pushed to DynamoDB Kinesis data stream, and we will have a consuming Lambda function to push the change to the connected client or clients, the front-end app. The second pattern is when a request to the API gets published straight to an event stream or to a message broker or queue. I call this pattern event first, but I have heard this pattern also referred to as storage first. Now, I know it's referring to the fact it's storing the request to a persistent middleware, the middleware is persistent. However, it sounds wrong, because when I hear storage, I think of a database or a storage service like S3 or another service with long-term storage capability. I know Kinesis does have a retention period of up to a year, but storage needs could exceed a year. Also, publishing to a message queue is short-term because meshes get removed when they are processed by a subscriber. If I were to call any pattern storage first, it would be the first pattern when we stored straight to the database table. But the table could easily be an object storage service like AWS S3, simple storage service. But back to the second pattern. In our example, we can use the AWS API Gateway to proxy to the Kinesis data stream and write the device payload records straight to the data stream. Again, if required, you can have a service or a function to serve the API endpoint and perform the write based on your requirements. And we could have two Lambda consumers that will process the event stream independently and at their own pace. One will store the payload in a DynamoDB table, and the other could trigger the pushing of notifications to update the front-end app, which we will come to shortly. But first, let's compare the two. So database first processes data in sequence, while event first allows parallel data processing as soon as the system receives it. As a result, database first provides higher data consistency than event first, since data is stored in the database before notifying the front-end app. Event first, on the other hand, has a higher degree of eventual data consistency, since notifying clients and storing data occur in parallel, or could occur in parallel. Additionally, due to parallel processing, event first reduces the time it takes for data to reach the front-end application, resulting in lower latency. Now, there is an alternative approach. You could instead add a Lambda function to serve the API endpoint and perform two network calls, one to publish an event and the other to store the request data in the database. However, you would need to design a distributed transaction, because what happens if one fails? How do you roll back? What if you can't roll back? Remember the two principles: don't lose events and don't do distributed transactions, because distributed transactions are complex to get right. Check out my video on how not to publish events for more information in the top right. Now, we need to push the events to the subscribed clients, which is the web application UI, the front-end app in this example. How would I do this? One approach would be to use WebSockets, and we would set up WebSockets by adding the following. One, we would add a new WebSocket API to the AWS API gateway, and we would configure three routes: connect, disconnect, and possibly a third called subscribe. Secondly, a DynamoDB table to hold the WebSocket connected client details. Thirdly, a Lambda function that serves the connect route and stores the client details in the table. Fourthly, a Lambda function that serves a disconnect route and removes the client details from the DynamoDB table on disconnect. And optionally, a Lambda function that serves the subscribe route. The function could modify the client subscription settings in the DynamoDB table. This is if we want clients to specify what events to receive and for what. When the front-end app starts up, the application will open a WebSocket connection. Then the connect Lambda function will update the client's connection table with the new details. The application could subscribe to a specific device notification by calling the subscribe route. Now, to the backend. We would have the consume Lambda function to fetch the subscribed connected client identifiers when an event gets pushed to the Kinesis data stream. Then the function will invoke a post HTTP request to the WebSocket API to invoke a callback message for each connected subscribed client using the connection identifier. And the clients, the instances of the front-end UI, would update their UI dashboards as and when updates are received. Okay, so we are using WebSockets to push events to the UI. However, you may ask, how do clients fetch data on startup? A solution is quite simple. You provide a REST API with endpoints, which clients can consume to fetch data from the database. You can mix, or use a GraphQL API, because GraphQL supports PubSub by default. Now, finally, many solutions I know expose a request-driven interface, and once an initial request is received or processed, they publish an event that will trigger downstream services using event-driven architecture. And also, solutions have mixed request-driven and event-driven methods of communication between systems and services to achieve their goal. Now, don't be fanatical and narrow-minded when it comes to designing systems. Use a range of tools in your toolbox. Don't use a hammer for a screw. Now, stay tuned, smash that like button and subscribe, because I will be doing a follow-up on how to incorporate other patterns and services.